Ignition sequence start. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Launch commit. Liftoff. We have liftoff with Apollo 14. 3 minutes past the hour.
Apollo 14 launched on January 31st, 1971. 5 days later, astronauts Alan Shepard and Edgar Mitchell walked on the moon, while Stuart Roosa, a former U.S. Forest Service smoke jumper, orbited above in the command module. Packed away in a small container in Roosa's personal kit were over 400 tree seeds. Scientists were curious to know if tree seeds, after their journey into the microgravity of space, would sprout and look the same as Earth-grown trees.
So they returned from the moon trip, and during decontamination of the space vehicle, they thought they were destroyed. And they got all mixed up. They came out of the containers, and they ended up at a Forest Service lab who they decided to try to see if they would grow.
And grow they did. The seedlings, now known as moon trees, were given away. Most of them were planted during public ceremonies in 1976 to help commemorate the U.S. bicentennial. Five of these lunar legends made their way to Indiana. There is one moon tree, a sycamore, still growing on the Indiana State House property in downtown Indianapolis. Three other moon tree locations are in southern Indiana.
I don't think anybody back then thought that they were going to be that big of a deal. And so they got planted, all over the world and country, like I said, and no one really wrote down where they were, or if they did, those records have been lost. So several people have taken an interest in the trees and have documented right around 80 of them across the country. And we're lucky enough to have these two sweet gums here and three other trees in the state of Indiana.
These two sweet gum moon trees are located on the property of the Hoosier National Forest Ranger Station in Tell City, Indiana.
Two or three people stop by every year, and we're not stingy about them. There's one gentleman that lives in Germany that actually got a hold of us, and he was in the States, and he's collecting seed from the different moon trees and taking them to germinate them and let them live on. So we did help him get some seed from these two trees, and I'm assuming other people that have them on their property were equally accommodating. There were seeds that they kept here on Earth from the same genetic background that they germinated as well, and there wasn't any significant difference. So I don't think anybody knew at the time, but that was the hypothesis, that it wouldn't matter.
We see some top dieback, and it's starting to expand, which can be problematic. We're going to treat it chemically, and then hopefully it'll heal the trees.
It's probably been forgotten a little bit, but it's a neat thing to talk to people about when they're here. Every year I go work with fifth grade classes, and I always take a branch off one of these trees and tell them the story. So hopefully that'll live on. There's not too many people that can claim that they have a couple moon trees in their city that they can just go look at or have a picnic under. It's a piece of our history that, may not happen again for a really long time, if at all. So I think we need to remember they're here and not forget what Stuart did. They're standard issue sweet gums, as far as I can tell. They do not drop green cheese balls that I'm aware of.
Just a few miles east of Tell City is Cannelton, Indiana, the home of Camp Cook Girl Scout Camp. That's the location of another Indiana moon tree.
If we have people coming up here at the camp, the moon tree is talked about a little bit. So I know our campers and people that visit ask questions about it. Just the history of being a moon tree, I think, is a good thing for us to relate to. We actually went to the moon, took seeds, came out, and it's growing. So I think it's pretty significant for it.
One has to wonder, though, if a moon tree needs any kind of extra care.
We've just been trying to, get the ground, get the roots covered up, keep it trimmed a little bit from laying on the ground. When the kids are on site, it's well used. We had an ice storm came through here and busted some limbs off it. but it really bloomed again. You know, it just still, just like every other tree, you know, it just kept growing right back. No little moon Martians or anything.
What kind of effect does long exposure to a moon tree have on the human body? Another moon tree is located in Lincoln State Park. Michael Cruz, the park's interpretive naturalist, has a long history with this site's moon tree.
I know it was the 200th anniversary of the beginning of the country, so it was 1976. And it was a big Girl Scout encampment here at the park. And somehow the Girl Scouts got a hold of one of the seedlings and planted it here, along with a time capsule. And so there were hundreds, if not thousands, of Girl Scouts that were involved in the planting of the tree originally. I know my sisters were involved in it, and I remember it myself as a little kid. I was actually here. The tree seems to be normal, and you know, it's fairly healthy as far as I'm concerned. Still seeding, and it's growing. The crown's very large, and yeah, it looks like it's doing pretty well, actually. You know, maybe they're still secretly looking at it. I don't know. It's on our property maps, our Lincoln State Park property maps, as an attraction, and people come just to see it. I know that. And I get a lot of questions about it. Where's the moon tree? Why do you call that the moon tree?
As the moon trees continue to grow, they serve as a reminder of the Apollo program's manned missions to the moon, and as a tribute to astronaut Roussa, while they reach back toward the moon they once circled.